Hey there, thanks for stopping by. My name is Gary Hirche and I'm a composer for film and television. Today I'm going to show you a way how to write interesting and emotional textures for your orchestral pieces. We are going to focus mostly on the accompaniment of melodies and use a technique that I call multilayered block orchestration. And now, let's get going. So what actually is multilayered block orchestration? Well, it's a special kind of homophonic writing. That means that the melody should always be the most important part of our arrangement. All the other elements have to stand in the background and play a supportive role. Basically, in multilayered block orchestration, you stack several accompaniment patterns on top of each other and assign them to different instrument groups. You'll see how I orchestrated one melody in three different ways, ranging from filigree to absolutely massive. I'll give you some tips along the way, and in the end, I have an announcement to make and a small bonus tip for you, so lots of interesting stuff ahead. As an example, we'll have a look at the accompaniment textures in my orchestra piece called The Queen's Escape. Here we are in Cubase, and I will play you the mock-up of the piece, which was later recorded by a full orchestra. Here's the main theme. For its first appearance, I wanted the theme to sound rather small and filigree. All the choices I made for the instrumentation, the playing techniques, ranges, and dynamics were guided by the idea of being rather delicate and filigree. Together with chords, the melody would look like this. But for my taste, just adding sustained chords would have been too static. Instead, I decided to give these chords some rhythm and assigned them to the lower strings playing pizzicato. Here I left a lot of space between the individual chords in order to let the melody breathe and make room for the other elements that are going to be added later. If you write in multilayered block orchestration, keep your arrangements as transparent and clear as possible. Make your layers simple and give them space to breathe. Never clutter your arrangement already with the first accompaniment layer. Here I also put the chords in the lower register in order not to get in the way of the melody's register. The next thing that I added is the harp playing triplet arpeggios. It's subtle, but to me this is the backbone of the whole texture. It contains all the harmonic information that you need and it is placed in the middle register. It almost acts like a canvas on top of which all the other elements are placed. For example, the violins playing an eighth note triplet pattern. This gives drive and forward momentum to this section. Here I made use of an old interval progression called horn fifths. That means that one voice is going stepwise while the other one is playing broken triads. Sometimes the violins interfere with the register of the melody. Therefore, I marked them pianissimo and added also a glockenspiel to the melody in order to highlight it even more. The violin layer is not only here to make the orchestration more interesting. To me, it's also an element of storytelling. Just think about it. The whole piece is called The Queen's Escape. So she's on a flight, maybe she's on a horse, and these fast triplet patterns illustrate how fast the horse is moving, and even more important, how nervous she is. There are only two small ingredients left that I added here. One is a short fanfare in bar 36 played by the trumpets with mutes. And at the end of the melody, I added some woodwinds in order to make it thicker and lead over to the next section of the piece. And now let's hear everything together. So you see, using these multiple layers really can add depth and color to your orchestration. but always have an eye on the balance. Don't clutter your structure with too many layers, and always keep your melody in the foreground. The best way to ensure this is to ask yourself two simple questions. One, is the layer that I want to add really necessary, or does it add to the storytelling of the piece? And second, does the layer interfere with the range, dynamics, instrumentation, or playing techniques of the melody or the other layers? Now we come to the second appearance of the theme, where I wanted to show it in its full bloom with a lot of power and high agility. That's how it sounds. The melody is played by all the strings except for the basses in three different octaves, plus a glockenspiel, which plays even one octave higher. In this case, the backbone of my texture comes from the French horns playing eighth note repetitions of the chords. Here I left a rest for the players to breathe. Never forget these important details if you are going to record with live players. For the woodwinds, I decided to write something that I would call a wall of sound. They play triplet arpeggios over a wide range and in contrary motion. Here I used two principles. The one is the horn fifth progression that I mentioned earlier, and the other one is dovetailing. That means if you have a longer arpeggio or scale, which would be quite difficult for one player, then you can split it in half and give it to two players. In the end, you stitch it together by overlapping the first and last note of each sequence, so it will be rhythmically coherent, make things a lot easier for your individual players, but it also will give you an interesting color shift for your orchestration. Now let's come to the low brass section, supported by the contrabassoon and the double basses, which play some accented chords. By hitting the heavy beats in the first bar, these chords add a lot of weight to the texture. But later on, they are still sparse enough to leave space for the melody and the other layers. I also added a trumpet fanfare, which acts as a counterpoint to our melody. This is pretty prominent, but on the one hand, our melody is heavily orchestrated, and on the other hand, we've already heard this theme. If you play your theme the second time, it's absolutely okay to give it a little sidekick. And of course, I added some percussion to the whole thing. This accents the most important beats of the whole section, but it also gives it a crispness and a playful drive. And now let's hear everything one more time. A great example of this kind of orchestration is the opening scene of How to Train Your Dragon 1. The music by John Powell is so colorful and immersive that it really takes the film to another level. He is a real master of multilayered block orchestration, even though he might not call it that way. And now let's get to the big climax of the piece, where we hear our main theme one more time. For its last appearance, I wanted the theme to sound majestic and stirring. So I gave it to the four French horns playing in unison and the violins playing in octaves. In order to give it a majestic feeling, I augmented the theme, which means that all the rhythmic values are doubled in length. Then I added some sustained chords in the heavy brass. These chords form the massive backbone of our texture here. And they also act as an orchestral pedal, which means that they are a substitute for the damper pedal on the piano, which gives you these long ringing notes. In order not to get static and push things forward, I used some polyrhythmic patterns in the violas, celli, and harp. The violas are playing a three-note motif here, while the celli are playing four-note arpeggios. And if you stack them on top of each other, they shift a little bit every time they repeat. So this fluctuating web of sound that you get works great with live players. It might not always sound great with your samples, but it really works in the orchestral context. On top of this, I added some fast scales in the woodwinds. This again adds depth to the texture. And my theory is that the rhythmical difference between the fast moving triplet runs and a majestically slow melody makes the theme feel even bigger than it actually is. A great example for this effect can be heard at the end of the fugue of Benjamin Britten's great piece, The Young Person's Guide to the Orchestra. The last thing that I added here, again, was the percussion section. And now let's hear the whole thing in one run. Okay, and I promised you a bonus tip, and that is, don't place your melody always in the highest register. A great way to shake things up is to give it to the lowest instruments of your orchestra. Here in the example that I'm going to play you, I gave it to the trombones, the tuba, and the low string instruments, and together they really form a powerful bass melody alliance. In order to let this kind of texture feel grounded, you should hit the root notes of the chords from time to time in your bass melody. But apart from this, the whole thing works with the same principles we mentioned for the earlier examples. Okay, let's sum things up. The most important thing is be creative with your accompaniment layers. They can add so much interest in your compositions, but they are also a great storytelling device. On the other hand, look at the balance of your textures. They should always be as transparent and clear as possible. And the melody should always stand in the foreground. If there are any issues, you just can separate the instrumentation, playing techniques, ranges, and dynamics a little bit more, and then you should be fine. Just have fun with multi-layered block orchestration and try it for yourself. And if you like the piece The Queen's Escape, there's a whole album of cinematic music by me coming in June 22. I recorded it with the German Film Orchestra Babelsberg, and on this channel I will have a look at different pieces from the album and analyze different aspects of them. I also will analyze other composers' work and have a look at my favorite cues together with you. There are also some other tutorials coming up, so stay tuned. Okay, thanks for watching the video. I hope you liked it. Maybe you want to leave me a comment and tell me what you think about it. I hope you join me for the next one. So see you soon. Bye bye.